Joseph Paul Franklin, the racist killer. One of America's worst serial killer. Franklin was born James Clayton Vaughn, Jr., in Mobile, Alabama. Franklin was the eldest son of an alcoholic drifter, who often abandoned his family for months or years at a stretch. Siblings remember that James Vaughn, Sr., would celebrate infrequent homecomings by beating his children, with James, Jr., absorbing the worst punishment. As a youth, Franklin went in for food fads and fringe religions, dropping out of high school after an accident left him with severely impaired eyesight. The injury was a two-edged sword, exempting Franklin from military conscription, and he married in 1968, at an age when many young men were sweating out the draft lottery, fearful of the war in Vietnam. Soon after their wedding, Franklin's bride noted a change in his personality like night and day. He began to beat her, emulating the father he hated. And on other occasions she would find him inexplicably weeping. Around the same time, their all-white neighborhood was racially integrated, and Franklin began to veer hard right into the realm of pathological bigotry. The next few years were marked by ugly racial incidents and sporadic arrests for carrying concealed weapons. Franklin was increasingly drawn to the American Nazi Party, lapsing into the segregationist movement full-time after mother's death in 1972. Moving to Atlanta, he joined the neo-fascist National States Rights Party, simultaneously holding membership in the local Ku Klux Klan. Franklin began insulting interracial couples in public, and on Labor Day 1976, he trailed one such couple to a dead-end street in Atlanta, spraying them with chemical mace. Around this time, Franklin legally changed his name, shedding the last links with his normal life. He spent the years 1977 to 1980 wandering across the South and Midwest, employing 18 pseudonyms, changing cars and weapons frequently, dyeing his hair so often that his hair came close to falling out. Along the way, he killed some 13 persons in a frenzied, Franklin waged a one-man war against minorities. Franklin launched his campaign in the summer of 1977, bombing a Chattanooga synagogue on July 29th. 9 days later, he shot and killed Alphonse Manning and Tony Schwen, an interracial couple, in Madison, Wisconsin. On October 8th, Gerald Gordon was killed by sniper fire as he left a bar mitzvah in the St. Louis suburb of Richmond Heights. Harold McIver, the black manager of a fast food restaurant in Doraville, Georgia, was working the night shift when a sniper took his life on July 22, 1979. 3 months later, in Oklahoma City, another interracial couple came under attack from the itinerant gunman. Jesse Taylor was hit 3 times with a high-powered rifle before he expired. A single round through the chest killed Marion Brissett as she ran to the aid of her common-law husband. Franklin struck twice in Indianapolis during January 1980, killing black men with long-distance rifle fire in 2 separate attacks. On May 3, 1980, he allegedly killed a young white woman, Rebecca Bergstrom, dumping her body near Toma, in central Wisconsin. On June 8, 1980, he surfaced in Cincinnati, bagging cousins Daryl Lane and Dante Brown from his sniper's perch on a nearby railroad trestle. A week later, in Johnstown, Pennsylvania, Franklin shotgunned a black couple, Arthur Smothers and Kathleen McCullough, as they crossed a downtown bridge. On August 20, 1980, joggers Ted Fields and David Martin were cut down by rifle fire in Salt Lake City, Utah. Still desperate to ignite a race war in the United States, Joseph Paul Franklin sought more prominent targets, hoping to draw attention to his cause. But he also found satisfaction in impulsive, isolated murders. When it seemed no one would ever catch him, he got careless. Arrested in Kentucky on September 25, 1980, and recaptured a month later, after escaping to Florida, Franklin faced a marathon series of state and federal trials, with mixed results. In 1982, he was acquitted of federal civil rights charges in the May 1980 shooting that left civil rights leader Vernon Jordan critically injured in Fort Wayne, Indiana. Utah juries found him guilty of murder and civil rights violations. Franklin was serving life on those counts in 1983, when he confessed the 1978 sniping that crippled Hustler magazine publisher Larry Flint in Gwinnett County, Georgia. Franklin was indicted for that crime but never tried, since he already faced stiffer penalties in other states. More convictions followed, for the Chattanooga bombing, for the double murder in Wisconsin, for the murder of Gerald Gordon, killed leaving a Clayton, Missouri synagogue in 1977, his first death sentence, for the June 1980 double murder in Cincinnati, for the 1978 murder of William Tatum, shot while talking to a white woman outside a Chattanooga restaurant. Other crimes confessed by Franklin without further convictions include the 1980 murder of teenager Nancy Santomero at a peace retreat in West Virginia, the 1980 murders of an interracial couple in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, the 1980 murders of an interracial couple in Johnstown, Ohio, and the separate 1979 murders of a white woman and a black man in Decatur, Georgia. Overall, it is believed Franklin is responsible for at least 18 murders and 5 non-fatal shootings in 11 states, plus 2 bombings and 16 bank robberies. Franklin's execution was complicated, as it took place during a period when various European drug manufacturers refused or objected on moral grounds to having their drugs used in a lethal injection. In response, Missouri announced that it would use for Franklin's execution a new method of lethal injection, which used a single drug provided by an unnamed compounding pharmacy. A day before his execution, U.S. District Judge Nanette Laffrey, Jefferson City, granted a stay of execution over concerns raised about the new method of execution. A second stay was granted that evening by U.S. District Judge Carol E. Jackson, St. Louis, based on Franklin's claim that he is mentally incompetent to be executed. An appeals court quickly overturned both stays, and the Supreme Court subsequently rejected final appeals. Franklin was executed at the Eastern Reception Diagnostic and Correctional Center in Bon Terre, Missouri on November 20, 2013. He was 63 years at the time of his execution. The execution began at 6:07 a.m. and he was pronounced dead at 6:17 a.m. His execution was the first lethal injection in Missouri to use phenobarbital alone instead of the conventional three-drug cocktail. Thank you for watching Death Row.